Maranatha, the Lord comes. Dear brethren, I have a special request. Pray for me. We need the Holy Spirit to guide us as we preach. We need the Holy Spirit to guide us as we listen to His word. We need the Holy Spirit to open our heart to receive His message. Brethren, I invite you to open your Bibles in Titus chapter 2, 11 to 14. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us, that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Brethren, our mass for this night is based on these verses here. First of all, brethren, Paul says that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Then none has excuse to be lost, because Christ paid the price of our salvation for the whole world, for everyone who lives in the past, for everyone who lives in the present, and for everyone who lives in the future. His grace is sufficient to save everyone, inhabitant of this planet. But what is grace? Grace is an attribute of God exercised toward undeserving human beings. We did not seek for it, but it was sent in search for us. Grace is unmerited favor. Grace is power to do God's will. Divine grace is the great element of saving power. Without it, all human effort is unavailing. Then, brethren, we depend on grace for our salvation 100%. Brethren, I'd like to say to you that I will not be saved because I am a member of the church for 50 plus years. No. I will not be saved because I am a GC officer. No. I will not be saved because I preach righteousness by faith. No. I will be saved because I believe in Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. He died for me. He's interceding on my behalf, and He will come to take us home. Now, very important question. Are you in Christ? Let us see. Not. If you do not acknowledge yourself erring, helpless, condemned sinners. Not. If you are exalting and glorifying self. If there is any good in you, it is wholly attributable to the mercy of a compassionate Savior. Your birth, your reputation, your wealth, your talents, your virtues, your piety, your philanthropy, or anything else in you, or connect with you, will not form a bond of union between you and Christ. Your connection with the church, the manner in which your brethren regard you, will be of no value unless you believe in Christ. Then, dear brethren, why are we saved? What the reason? What the base of our salvation? The Bible says, he who believes in Jesus Christ and will be baptized, this will be saved. You must rely wholly upon his saving grace. Now, brethren, you have here a wonderful truth. In the matchless gift of his Son, God has encircled the whole world with an atmosphere of grace, as real as the air which circulates around the globe. Brother, that's not wonderful? As much as we have air to breathe, we have grace to receive. All who choose to breathe this life-giving atmosphere will live and grow to the stature of men and women in Christ Jesus. But brethren, we can breathe God's grace, but we can refuse to breathe God's grace. Sometimes when I'm traveling, I'm shocked when people, they choose to be in a close place to smoke. They decide to breathe impure air. And sadly, brethren, you have this liberty to choose if you breathe God's grace or not. I hope that all of you here will breathe God's grace to be saved. Christ died for us. Christ died for me. Christ died for you. He does not treat us according to our desert. Although our sins have merited condemnation, he does not condemn us. Year after year, he has borne with our weakness and ignorance, with our ingratitude and waywardness. Notwithstanding our wanderings, his hand is stretched out still to save us. Through the grace of Christ, we may accomplish everything that God requires from us. Now, brethren, the Apostle Paul continues saying, as we accept God's grace, then we need to deny ungodliness and renounce sin. Brethren, that great preacher, Moody, he used to offer a Bible to his new converted people. And he put in the Bible, either this book, join you with Christ. If you love this book, you are loving Christ. If you reject this book, you are rejecting Christ. Everything that the Word of God condemns must be rejected. If we love Christ, we hate sin. If you love sin, we cannot love Christ at the same time. Brethren, there is no middle ground. We cannot love Christ and love sin at the same time. We cannot be servant of Christ and slave of sin at the same time. No. If we surrender our life to Christ, we are free from condemnation. We receive power to overcome sin. Now, Paul continues saying that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Now, a question, how can we live a life of righteousness and godliness in this present world? A very simple word. Walking with Jesus. The Bible says that Enoch, Noah, Abraham walked with God. What does it mean to walk with God? And what would be the result? If men walk with God, he will hide them in the cleft of the rock. Thus hidden, they can see God, even Moses saw as Moses saw him. By the power and the light that he imparts, they can comprehend more and accomplish more than their finite judgment had deemed possible. Brad, what was the result of Enoch walking with God? What was the result? He walked with God so closely that finally God took him to be eternally with him. And then, Brad, that's the destiny of God's people, if we are faithful in walking with Christ. Now, let's go a little bit deeper. What's the meaning of walking with God? Like Enoch, we must walk with God. Look at this expression, brethren. Bringing the will into submission to His will. I found that that's a wonderful explanation of the meaning. What's the meaning of walking with God? Submitting my will to His will. We must be willing to go where Jesus leads us, willing to suffer for His dear sake, in seeking to save the soul for whom Christ had died, conquering difficulties, keeping ourselves unspotted from the world. We reveal the genuineness of our religion. Faithful Christian, do not seek the easiest place, the lightest burden. They are found where there is hardest work to be done. Enoch not only meditated and prayed and put on the arm of watchfulness, but he came forth from pleading with God to plead with unbelievers. Interesting, brethren, that the mission of Christ also can be divided into parts. He spent nights on the mountain with God. And then he spent days with people trying to save them. Then he divided his life between the mountain and the plains to save people. This close connection. Brother, that's a very key word. Connection. 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 This close connection with God gave him courage to work the work of God. Enoch walked with God and had the testimony that this his way pleased God. This is the privilege of every believer today. There is a very important quotation in the book Christ Object Less, which says, there are Enochs in our days. What the meaning? There are people who walk daily with God. Now Paul goes a step further. He says, looking for that blessed hope, the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ. Brethren, a very important question. How do you feel when we say that Christ is coming soon? How do you feel? Comfortable? Happy? Or concerned? What's our feelings? When we understand that Christ is coming soon? Someone wrote an imaginary letter to the Lord. He said this way, dear Lord, don't come soon. I'm not ready. I have some projects. I need to make money. I need to have a big mansion. I need to finish my university. I need to get married. I need to have sons. I need to enjoy life. Please, Lord, don't come soon. Is this our prayer? No. If we love Christ, as soon as He comes, the better. To walk with God and have the witness that their ways please Him is an experience not to be confined to Enoch, to Elijah, to the patriarchs, to prophets, to apostles, and to martyrs. It's not only a privilege, but the duty of every follower of Christ to have Jesus enshrined in the heart, to carry Him with their lives, and they will indeed be fruit-bearing trees. Then, Brad, the question is that blessed hope your thought? Are you happy with this blessed hope? The second coming of Jesus had been the blessed hope of all believers from the very beginning to today. It is the climax of the plan of salvation when Christ comes to take his faithful children to the heavenly home. But let us imagine the gospel is a complete package. Christ was incarnate. He was born in this world. He became a man. He lived a perfect life 33 years old. He died on Calvary for us. He resurrected. He is interceding for us. Let us imagine that he would not come anymore. What would be the result? Frustration. But God's word prompted that he's coming to complete, to bring the plan of salvation to a climax. Brethren, let's remember this. We are pilgrims and strangers who are waiting, hoping, and praying for that blessed hope. Did you think about that? We are pilgrims. But I remember September 11, 2001. We were here in Roanoke, in our headquarters. Then we were shocked with the news that there was a big terrorist attack. Then I was caught by surprise, and I was thinking, this is not my world. That's not the place where you should live forever. We are what? What are we? We are pilgrims and strangers who are waiting, hoping, and praying for that blessed hope. The coming of the Lord has been in all ages the hope of his true followers. The Savior parting from the Mount of Olivet, that he would come again, lighted up the future of his disciples, filling their heart with joy and hope, sorrow could not quench, nor trials dim. Amid suffering and persecution, the appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ was that blessed hope. Brethren, about 3 months ago, I was visiting one of our pioneer. And he said to me a very precious word. He said, Brother Silva, every time that we see sunset, that's one day more to take us close to Jesus' second coming. Did you think about that? Another brother, a pessimist brother, he said to me, Brother Silva, every day that pass on, we are close to die. The other said, every sunset which comes, we are close to the second coming of Christ. Brethren, together with the second coming of Christ, we will see our dear beloved brethren who passed away. We will see our dear family. We will see those who accept the Lord from the very beginning of the world. Then together with the second coming of Christ, we receive many, many other blessings. John the Apostle, when he was in the rock Patmos, he hears the promise. Christ said to him, surely I come quickly. What was his answer? Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Can we pray, brother, for that? Can we pray that Christ should come as soon as possible? But the Bible said that before his second coming, in his first coming, he gave himself for us. What was the purpose? It's true that with his death, Christ paid for all our sins. But it's very important, very essential for our salvation. But not only that. He came to die for us, to restore us to the original creation. He came to redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Salvation, brethren, is not only eternal life. Eternal life is the last reward of salvation. But salvation is the act of the Lord to free us from the power of sin. Brethren, I'd like to remind all of you here that we're called to be a peculiar people. Zealous of good works. In Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 2 says, "For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God." What's the meaning of this word holy? Brethren, holy means separated for a holy purpose. For example, I can say that this book is a holy book. I can say that everyone who surrenders his life to Christ is a holy people, a holy person. Because he gave himself to the Lord to be his children, to be his servant. "For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God, and the Lord has chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself, above all the nations that are upon the earth." Deuteronomy 26, 18, 19 says, "And the Lord has avouched thee this day to be his peculiar people, as he has promised thee, and that thou shouldest keep all his commandments, and to make thee high above all nations which he has made, for his praise and in name and honor, and that thou mayest be a holy people unto the Lord thy God, as he had spoken." And the Apostle Peter, he says almost the same words in 2 Peter 2, verses 9 to 12. Brethren, let's keep special attention to this, what God expects from me and from you. "Ye are chosen generation, royal priesthood, holy nation, peculiar people, that it should shine forth the praise of him who has called you of darkness to his marvelous light, which in time past you were not a people, but now you are people of God." Brethren, one king in Europe, he wrote a letter to his son. His son was inclined to be involved in feasts and in pleasure of this world. And the king wrote to him, "Remember who you are. You are the son of king. Remember who you are." Brethren, let us remember who we are. Let us remember. We are children of God. Now, the Apostle Peter enters some very important details. "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which fight against the soul, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may be by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation." Then, brother, what's the meaning of peculiar people, holy people, special people, royal priesthood, holy nation, peculiar people? What's the purpose? What's the meaning? Our conversation, our procedure. Brethren, we cannot be slaves of appetite and passions because we are God's children. Our only safety is to stand as God's peculiar people. Brethren, the world is intimidating us. Many times when we are in the school, we are in the work, we are in the transportation, then we receive a strong pressure to deny our Lord. We are intimidated by the world. But our only safety is to stand as God's peculiar people. We must not yield one inch to the customs and fashions of this degenerate age, but stand in moral independence, making no compromise with its corrupt and idolatrous practices. Those who have seen the truth and felt its importance have had an experience in the thing of God. They need to teach sound doctrine to their children. Here, the inspiration is talking about the parents. They should teach their children to be believers. They need to talk about Jesus to their children. But are we doing that? Do I have time to call my little boy, my little girl, to say, look, my dear, Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. We are saved by the grace of God. Have we spoken this word to our children? They should make them acquainted with the great pillars of our faith. The reason why we are Seventh-day Adventists, why we are called as were the children of Israel to be a peculiar people, a holy nation, separate and distinct from all other people on the face of the earth. Shall those who are looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ gave himself for us be behind the religionists of the day who have no faith in himself, in Jesus, as peculiar people? The peculiar people whom he has purified to himself is to be translated from all without sin death, should not be behind others in good works, in their efforts. They should cleanse themselves for all iniquities, for all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. They should be as far ahead as of any other class of people on the earth, as their profession is more exalted than the others. Dear brethren, the Apostle John says that if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, then we have communion with one another, and the blood of Christ purifies us from all our sins. What's the condition? If what? If we walk in the light. Brother, can we be saved if we neglect the light? If we know the light but we don't obey it, can we be saved? The doctrine of the grace and salvation by the gospel is for all ranks and condition of men. It teaches to forsake sin, to have no more not to do with it. An earthly, sensual conversation suits not a heavenly calling. It teaches to make conscience of it, what is good. We must look to God in Christ as the object of our hope and worship. And at and in the glorious appearing of Christ, the blessed hope of Christians will be complete. To bring us to holiness and happiness was the end of Christ's death. Jesus Christ, that great God and our Savior, who saved us not only as God, much less as a man alone, but as a God-man. Two natures in one person. He loved us. He gave himself for us. And what can we do less than love and give ourselves to him? Brother, we mentioned yesterday, Christ gave himself for us, for our salvation. What should we do? We should give ourselves to him completely. Christ made no reservation, no reserve. He gave himself totally for our salvation. How should we give ourselves to him? Totally. Redemption from sin and sanctification of the nature go together and make a peculiar people of God, free from guilt and condemnation, and purified by the Holy Spirit. All Scripture is profitable. He is what it furnished for all part of duty and the right discharge of them. Let us inquire whether our whole dependence is put upon that grace which saves the lost, pardons the guilt, and sanctifies the unclean. And the further we are removed from boasting of fancy good works, of trusting them, so that the glory of Christ alone, the more zealous will be abounding good works. Brethren, in the second coming of Christ, we will be glorified. Our body will be transformed. But the glorification is only for sanctified people. Sanctification is only for justified people. Justification is only for repentant sinners. And repentance is only for those who surrender their life to Christ. Let us summarize. As we go to the foot of the cross, the Holy Spirit produces in us repentance. As we repent and confess our sins, we are justified. We are considered righteous before the universe. As we keep our connection with Christ, the Holy Spirit working in us, giving us power to overcome sin. Then by the power of the Holy Spirit and God's word, we are sanctified. If we persevere with Christ, we'll be glorified in the second coming of Christ. And then, brethren, we will be with the Lord forever and ever and ever. Dear brethren, is this our desire? Is this your desire? May the Lord bless us so that we can be steadfast in our faith, uniting with Christ and separate from the sin and world. Then we can say with our heart, Maranatha, the Lord is coming. Maranatha, the Lord is coming. May the Lord bless us and give us his grace, his protection. And as we leave this place, brethren, let us keep our connection to the Lord so that he can use us to represent his character before the world. And he will come soon to take us home. That's my wish and prayer. Amen. microphone. By the congregation sing. Microphone.
Hymn number 686.
Microphone.
No mic. Again. Beloved brethren, can you hear me now? I will invite the congregation to stand and sing together with the choir and the orchestra hymn number 686. 686. God be with you.
Thank you.
Brethren, before the benediction, I'd like to read Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen.